It's good morning to everybody, and a big thank you for joining us at the second service this morning. And just to say, it's really good to see everybody here. And if people are joining in from home, then that's also fantastic as well. Everybody is welcome. If this is the first time people are joining us, looking around, I would just like to say, you are very, very welcome, and we hope that you will remain with us, because at our church, all are welcome. So today we've got myself leading. My name is Vanessa, and we have Mark and Bob and Grace and John leading us in our worship, and it's been wonderful. We've had the service before, and it was truly, truly great. So thank you to them. Diana will be bringing the word to us today, and Paulette will be presiding at communion. Melinda and Christopher are going to be leading our prayers. So we gather together, and it's great to be able to do that. We haven't been able to do it for some time. We've had a couple of sessions back now, and let's hope that we can build on that. So let's stand together for our opening words. Now, we had very solemn words at a service yesterday. If you watched the funeral of Prince Philip, it was amazing, really, actually, because those solemn words led us to great peace and understanding of what the Christian faith is all about. And for anyone who watched it, it was truly moving. And as we begin our service, let's hope that those words from yesterday will be meeting with the joy and the promises that God has for us today, and indeed for tomorrow. So together we are going to say, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Death has met its master.
The Lord is risen.
We are risen with Christ.
The Lord is risen.
Eternal life is ours.
The Lord is risen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The glory of the Lord has risen upon us.
Let us rejoice and sing God's praise forever.
We're just going to light the Easter candle now. And just bear with us as we do that.
Morning, church, and morning, everyone at home. It's falling from the clouds.
Thank you. Thank you. Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call my son. lie down. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening."
The second reading is from John 10, 22 to 30. Then came a festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts, walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered round him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please come by your Holy Spirit, presence yourself with us this morning. May we feel your presence, know your leading and guiding. And Lord, teach us to hear you better. In Jesus' name, amen. So, this week we're thinking about listening to God. And in our first reading, Samuel clearly isn't recognizing the voice of the Lord. Whereas we read in John, Jesus said, "My sheep listen to my voice." And listening is a gradual learning process. We know that Jesus speaks because there are numerous passages that refer to his voice. Revelation says his voice is like the sound of rushing water. Well, I think that's pretty loud and clear. Whereas 1 Kings 19 says, "Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper." And I think some versions call that a still, small voice. And this time it's quiet. We need to learn to know and recognize his voice. And I think that's becoming more and more difficult in our modern world, where we have so many external voices vying for our attention. They bombard us with information throughout the day. We've got adverts and emails and texts and news flashes and Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and mobile phones and more. There's very little time or space to hear the Lord, and our heads and our brains are totally occupied. But there are many, many scriptures that encourage us to listen. Proverbs 4:20 says, "My son, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words." Proverbs 8, "Listen to my instruction and be wise." And in Matthew 17, in the Transfiguration, God says, "Listen to him," meaning Jesus. When the children of Israel were in the wilderness, the Lord provided fresh food every day. And it was no good keeping yesterday's manna because it was inedible, it was mouldy the following day. The Lord's Prayer said, "Give us this day our daily bread. And I used to think that was my piece of toast in the morning until I realised it was spiritual food. Because Proverb 4 goes on to tell us they are life. And we need that life. We need that fresh word from the Lord every day. God is seeking an intimate relationship with each one of us. But as with any relationship, it takes time and effort. Can you imagine talking to your husband or wife or friend, but never getting a response back? We do that, don't we, to God? We just pour it all out. But God is longing to reveal his thoughts to us via the Holy Spirit, and his purpose is so that we know him better. God is so good. He knows us through and through, and he speaks differently to each one of us, because he takes into account the type of people we are, our personality, and the way we hear. But we have to remember to tune in. I think that's why we're encouraged to spend time with him every morning, so we tune in to him for that day. Because otherwise the day just takes over, doesn't it? Phone goes, you check the emails, and one thing leads to another, and you've lost the day. So how does God speak to us? Well, if you use Balaam's donkey, expect anything. But mostly he uses the conventional ways. Sermons, something that someone says may just jump out and speak to being just for you. He might be reinforcing something you're thinking or something you're praying about. It may give you a piece of something you're struggling with. He speaks through friends. Faithful friends can speak from God into our lives. Maybe it's their testimony or experience that speak to us. And we think, oh, yeah, that's for me now. God speaks through nature. We sang it this morning, didn't we? The sun and the moon declare who you are. I think God speaks of his greatness and his creativity through nature, his majesty and his power. He speaks through his written word, and there's every single thing we need for life in there. He speaks through prophecy. It's a word for the church or an individual via somebody else. He speaks through tongues when they're interpreted. That is, in the days when we were able to meet for prayer. Pictures. Some people hear better by seeing it. And they get pictures. God speaks through dreams, and they can powerfully speak into our lives or for others, or they can be a warning. He speaks with an audible voice, whether it's loud or the whisper. And he speaks through a thought that's just dropped into our minds. However God speaks, he will never, never, never contradict his written word. We have that as our check and our safety net. Now I just want to pick up on the last thing, the thoughts. Because God speaks to us through our thoughts, and it's very important we discern where our thoughts come from and where they originate. Not every thought that pops into our mind is from God. They come from three main sources. From ourselves, from the enemy, or from God. The ones that come from ourselves normally start with I, me, or self. For example, I deserve it. My rights, poor me, that's the self-pity. Or maybe it's our emotions that are speaking, not based on facts or truth. The ones from the enemy are normally condemnation, guilt, legalism, fear, and lies. He tries so hard to get us to doubt God's goodness. And that's why it's so important to know God's word, so that we can combat the enemy's lies. The thoughts that come from God are love, acceptance, forgiveness, leading and guiding, that little nudge to forgive, that little nudge to ring someone or pray for someone. And the voice is always gentle, even if it's a nudge to forgive. If you want to learn more about hearing God, then I could recommend three books. Steve Sampson's You Can Hear the Voice of God, Jack Deere's Surprised by the Voice of God, or Wayne Drain, He Still Speaks. So learning to hear from God is a lifelong process, and it's exciting. Not to say it's easy. I think however many times you hear, it's a case of double-checking. So refer it back to Him. He will always make Himself clear. He will always repeat it. Isn't it just amazing to think that the creator of the universe, this majestic God that we've been singing to this morning, wants an intimate relationship with each one of us? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we so long to hear from you. Unblock our ears. Show us, Lord. Teach us to hear you better. Thank you that you persevere with us and you're still speaking to us. And you long to do so. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you to Diana for bringing that word to us, and as I said in the first service, I think it's probably well worth a second listen to if we're able to. So much there about listening and hearing. But now it's time to declare our creed. And as we do that, let us just remember that in doing the creed and standing and confessing it, we are confessing the truth of our faith that we follow. It isn't just about saying those words, it's saying to everyone what we believe. So let's stand if you're able to. And together we say, we believe in God the Father, who made the world and everything in it. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We believe in Jesus Christ, who came to this world as Saviour. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. This is the faith of all Christians, at all times and in all places. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And as we stand on that confession of faith, we are going to declare peace to each other. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." And they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Now we're just going to have our communion time, and if you're watching at home, we hope you'll be able to engage with this also.
The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is always right to give you thanks, God, our Creator, loving and faithful, holy and strong. You made us and the whole universe and filled your world with life. You sent your Son to live among us, Jesus, our Saviour, Mary's child. He suffered on the cross. He died to save us from our sins. He rose in glory from the dead. You send your Spirit to bring new life to the world and clothe us with power from on high. And so we join the angels to celebrate and say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Father, on the night before he died, Jesus shared a meal with his friends. He took the bread and thanked you. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this to remember me. After the meal, Jesus took the cup of wine. He thanked you and gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new promise of God's unfailing love. Do this to remember me. Jesus Christ has died. Jesus Christ has died. Jesus Christ is risen. Jesus Christ is risen. Jesus Christ will come again. Jesus Christ will come again. Father, as we bring this bread and wine and remember his death and resurrection, send your Holy Spirit that we who share these gifts may be fed by Christ's body and his blood. Pour out your Spirit on us, that we may love one another, work for the healing of the earth, and share the good news of Jesus as we wait for his coming in glory. For honour and praise belong to you, Father, with Jesus, your Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Under the current arrangements, the priest alone receives the wine on behalf of myself and on behalf of you all as well. And then the distribution of Holy Communion will be in the form of wafers. And that's going to happen without me speaking words. So I'm going to say them now for all of us before we come to the distribution. So I'll come to you where you are in your seats, and I will give each of you a wafer. So if you intend to receive communion today, if you'd like to join in with the Amen after these words of distribution. So the body and blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. All followers of Christ are welcome to receive communion. If you'd like to receive, if I can ask you to have your hands cupped in front of you like that when I come to you, and I will drop a wafer into your hands. If your hands are down, then I will just stand in front of you for a moment and pray a silent blessing for you. And once I've put the bread in your hands, you can then remove your mask and eat it. But if you can remember to replace your mask afterwards, that would be great. Thank you. There isn't a mask or a COVID precaution or any kind of barrier that can stop the presence of God from touching our hearts and our minds and communicating with us, and isn't that a wonderful, wonderful thing? Let's say together the words of this prayer. God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Shape our prayers by starting close to home and looking outwards, giving thanks to God and bringing our Father God, we give you thanks for our homes. We've spent a lot of time at home. Thank you for your provision for shelter and warmth in this cold spring. Thank you for our families and friends, those we live with or close by, and those far away, for their love, their friendship, their support. We pray for all who are homeless, or for whom home is not a place of safety. We pray for those who are lonely or anxious. In a moment of silence, Father God, we lift before you those known to us, those you have laid on our hearts. Father God, thank you for our church. Thank you for all the many ways you are at work within our church community. Thank you, God, for live streaming with us and Zooming with us. And thank you, God, for being with us now when we meet together in person in your name. We pray for every member of this church and for those on the edges looking in. Father God, would you increase our faith? Teach us how to pray. Show us your way. In a moment of silence, we pray for those we know who are looking in, seeking you, or searching. Show us how to get alongside them and connect.
Consider our nation. Our thanks are to God for the example of service and devotion reflected in the life of the Duke of Edinburgh. And we ask God's peace and blessings be on Her Majesty the Queen as she copes with her sadness and continues her duty to lead this nation and the Church of England. As we gradually emerge from the restrictions we've been facing together, we give thanks for the progress this country sees in vaccinating our friends and our families. And on this sunny morning, we praise with joy the coming of spring, taken over from the gloom of winter. May our daily lives transform the examples of kindness and service we see around us and amongst us into a generous and compassionate society, appreciating the blessings we have and sharing these with others. And also, in a moment of silence, we lay before you our own concerns and our own hopes for our nation. When we look wider beyond the shores of our own island, we are grateful for the community of nations which brings such richness into our lives. Lord, we know that our own struggles are mirrored in the billions of people in Europe, in Africa, in America, in Asia, and in Australasia, knowing that these communities share with us similar hopes, similar fears, and similar joys. Amen.
Our God, we ask all these prayers in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you like to stand?
Oh,
Lord, thank you that one day we will rise again. And one day we will see you face to face. Thank you, God, for that. Amen. Crown him with many crowns. Finally,
You should all have had your documentation on the ADCM, either electrically or by paper copy. If you haven't had that yet, could you please contact Ali and she'll make sure you get that coming through. And it's a glorious day in every sense of the word being here. It's really lovely to be with you. So have a good week and see you next week.
How many ways can you get to the stage with electric view? So we're coming to the end of our service, but we'd just like to thank Melinda and Christopher for their prayers and for the band this morning. And in the first service, we did give them a little round of applause because the blending of voices and everything this morning was just lovely. So can we do that again? Lovely. And Diana's word, as we said, was just very good for us to ponder on for the rest of the week. But it is time for us to go out now into that big wild world. And as Andrew was just drawing attention to the fact that we are small in number at the moment, that sense of buzz that we love in this place, it's so sad that it's not here. But I was just thinking about if it's good enough for the Queen to sit with a mask on, I guess it's good enough for us as well. And we do long for that time when we can be back together, but we've just got to learn patience and wait and be thankful that we are at this stage, even because it could have been so much worse, couldn't it? But we have to go out into the world just now. So our final words together. God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of everlasting life. Amen. God the Son, who in bursting from the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith. Amen. God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples with the life of the risen Lord, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace.
Amen.
So with the power that raised Jesus from the dead, work within you. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Just a couple of things before we leave is to remind you that there is the